Hi, it's Steve. Today is day 8 of my 30 days of video series and also water fasting at the same time. So a quick update on the fast. Since it's day 8, I've made it past the first week, so that's pretty cool. Starting off on week 2 now. My energy's been great today. Just feeling physically, mentally, emotionally great. Totally the opposite of yesterday where I just felt really sluggish. So today my energy's like on an upswing. The weird thing about fasting is you can never really predict how your energy is going to be each day. So yeah, it's a bit of a crapshoot. Wake up in the morning and sometimes it's just like I can barely get out of bed and I want to sleep in an extra couple of hours. And other days it's just like waking up and feeling terrific. So today was one of those terrific days and I'm happy for that. Obviously on a fast you're going to lose some weight. So I've already lost a little over 10 pounds now. That's cool. I'm not really doing this primarily for weight loss, but I know a lot of people do get into fasting for weight loss, but that's one of the, it's one of the side effects of not eating any food. Another thing that happened today is in the past week as I've been uploading these videos, I got really sick of the slow upload speeds because it just takes forever to upload some of these files. I'm shooting these in 1080p and the files can be like 3-4 gigabytes, depending on how long I make these videos. And it just has been really slow uploading these to YouTube. So I upgraded to gigabit internet today. The guy came over this morning and installed it and had to, run this extra fiber cable to the house and stuff. So it took him almost 5 hours to do the installation, but it's up and running now. So I'm really excited about that. So hopefully when this video is done, I'll get a chance to try it out and see how fast it uploads. I did some testing on the upload speed and it's way, way faster than what I had before. So that's pretty cool. It's gigabit upload and download. So that's really nice. So that'll be an extra convenience. And it's only costing me an extra $32 a month. So that seems like a pretty good deal. The main topic I wanted to talk about today is sort of an extension of what I talked about on day 2 in this video series, the video about overcoming scarcity. I want to talk about providing value and contributing because I think this is an area where a lot of people screw up or they get confused. They're not sure about this providing value thing. I've shared many times that if you want to generate income, provide some value to people. Money is a medium of exchange for sharing value. So if you're not providing any value, don't expect to get much money in return or have people doing favors for you, things like that. So what is this value thing? What does it really mean? I mean, value is basically some kind of change or transformation in a person's life or state of being. So what are you changing? Now, this could be a really, simple change or a complicated one. Basically, you're taking them from their old reality to their new reality. And, an example, I guess, of a simple change would be somebody's hungry and you feed them. That transformation has been on my mind a lot lately, for obvious reasons. Another one is like somebody has a crappy phone and they get a new phone. So now they have extra technology, better features and things like that. Faster processor, a nicer screen, whatever. There's also, more complicated transformations, like somebody has a job they hate and now you're helping them find a career they love. Or somebody has no relationship and you're helping them find somebody that they can connect with and fall in love. All types of transformations are possible, but the whole idea behind value is that you're changing a person's life for the better in some way. It's very subjective, of course, but the key mistake people make here is that when they provide value for others, they guess about the value. They think that creating the value in a vacuum all by themselves is a good idea. And honestly, that's a stupid approach because almost always you're going to miss when you do that. You're going to create something that nobody wants because you're thinking of the value in terms of you. But the value is really what the other person receives. You can create something beautiful. You can create a book, you can create artwork, but if people don't like it, it's not gonna sell. If they don't receive it as value for them, you're out of luck. And it really saddens me how many times people have sent me ebooks or told me about things they've created that nobody's buying because they created it in a vacuum all by themselves. And nobody cares. And, you know, it's not a good thing to hear when someone comes to me and says, "Hey, Steve, I just finished writing my book. How do I market it now?" No, no, don't do that. You don't start with the creation process first. You start with the marketing. You start with figuring out who your audience is and how you're going to sell this and what the value is going to be for that person. You don't just come up with your brilliant idea all by yourself and then just, you know, spit it out, put it in some kind of format, you know, form or whatever, and then and figure out how you're going to provide this to people or share it or sell it or whatever. That's just totally ass backwards. And it's, you know, there's just so much creative effort that gets wasted when people do that. And it's almost always coming from a very needy approach. Like, I need some money. I need to get something going. I need some income. I need to create something. And you go and you create that by yourself. And then you get stuck on the marketing side because you realize what you've created is not something that's easy to sell. You don't know how you're going to get to your target market. You don't know if people, when they receive it, if they're actually going to value it and they're going to receive the value from it, if it's actually going to have the transformational effect that you want it to. And, you know, you see this all the time with really creepy sales pages then where they created something that they're hoping is going to provide value for people. And then they push you to buy, and they put in all these fake and phony, you know, transformations and overload it with just like testimonials that seem fake and trying to get you to be convinced that this product will give you the desired transformation. And it's just not the way to go. Then you end up getting, you know, really deep into like all this kind of manipulative crap, all kinds of cheesy copywriting methods and things like that to get people to buy. And then when they actually get your product, they often end up disappointed. I've seen products with like 50% or higher return rates because of, you know, that kind of approach. And they think that's not so bad. So what's the solution if you're not going to use that approach of create something and then figure out how to sell it? What's the solution? Well, the solution is largely the opposite of that. It's you need to find problems and challenges that people have and then figure out how to help them solve it. And, you know, as one simple thing that got me thinking this way, when I was in the computer gaming industry many years ago, I went to the Game Developers Conference, and there was a speaker there who gave a pretty interesting talk. His business was just doing so-so. He had, you know, a bunch of employees, and they were for many years, I think it was something like 8 years, just kind of flatlining income-wise and not doing much. Their games were just selling so-so. And then, very quickly, they went through this transformation where their games started selling millions of copies and they were making millions of dollars and the cash was just pouring in and hiring more people. And they continued like that for years. And he says, you know, would you like to know what changed along the way? And everybody in the audience was like, yeah, tell us. And he said, in the beginning, when our sales pretty much sucked, or they were just mediocre, they were making games for themselves. And in that second period, where they were flourishing, they were making games for other people, for their players. They found out who their target audience was, and they made games for those people. Which that, you know, they as developers were not nearly as into as the games that they were making for themselves. So it was a tough change to make. Now, I do believe you can massage things a bit so that when you create things for other people, it's also something that you enjoy. You know, if you think of this as the circle of all the things you could create for yourself that you would love, and this is a circle where you know, all the things you could create that other people would love, there's probably a, you know, an area in the middle where they intersect, and you can work in that area, you know, work in the intersection between the two. So instead of having to, just make stuff for yourself that nobody wants, or make stuff that other people want that you hate making, work in that middle zone. That's what works the best. And you know, it was just a simple flip-flop in their business model, a simple change going from, you know, making things for themselves to making things for other people. The way the economy works, if you want other people's money, then it's important that other people receive the value. It's not about you, okay? Don't get all, you know, needy and driven by what you need. Nobody cares. I don't care. The market doesn't care. The world doesn't care that much about you making money. What it cares about, you know, other people care about receiving value that they want to receive. So let me give you a pretty simple, it's not that difficult to understand, five-step process for how to create and provide value for other people. And this is going to be somewhat general, so it doesn't matter what field you're in. Step number one, figure out who your target market is. Who are the people? Okay, what is the person you're trying to help? So start with who. Okay, I mean, yeah, I know there's all this start with why crap out there. That's good too for your life purpose and so on. But if you want to sell something, if you want to provide value to people, start with who. Start with the people. Who are the people that you're providing this value for? When I was in the computer game industry, I would not even think in those terms. I would just make that mistake of making games just in a vacuum, playing them myself, and then trying to release them, and the sales sucked. I think my first four games combined were making about $300 a month total. So each game was selling just a few copies a month, and it was like each game was making about $75 a month. Not much to live off of. But then the next game I wrote, I decided to do things a little differently. I thought, I'm tired of writing games that suck. So I did some market research, and I went to game download sites, and I looked at different categories of game downloads, like action games, arcade games, puzzle games, strategy games, card games, and so on. And I thought, okay, where is there a lot of demand, but the competition is not that fierce, where I could actually create something that would do well. Now, in say like action game categories, you know, like those 3D shoot 'em ups, I would see lots and lots of downloads. They were really popular. And this was back in, I think it was like 1998, 99, I was doing this research. So yeah, they're still popular today. But you know, back then those games were getting lots of downloads, but I'm thinking, damn, I can't compete because I just didn't have the budget for that. So I couldn't create, you know, some value in that category that was going to be all that competitive. So I thought, okay, screw that category. As I went on, I thought, okay, card games, there was a lot of crap in there. And I thought I could, you know, I definitely have this programming and design skills to make something better than most of the offerings there. And they were very popular, things like Solitaire, getting lots and lots of downloads. But I would put a bullet in my brain if I had to write card games for a living. It just seemed really boring. So I said, screw that, for a different reason. That's maybe providing value for other people, but that's not going to make me happy. So I'm not doing that. Then I saw this category, puzzle games, and certain types of puzzle games. And I thought, interesting. There's a lot of crap in this category that's getting a lot of good downloads, like really ugly graphics and hideous sound effects and like very low on the polish, but people are downloading, playing these things. And I'm thinking, wow, I could compete in this. You know, in a few months, I could create something that would do well in this category, probably. But I narrowed it even further, and I thought, what kind of game do I want to create here? I thought there's going to be constantly people pumping out stuff at the low end. And I mean, by low end, I mean kind of the low end of the mental scale of puzzle games, like those stupid match three games, you know, you could play the whole thing with just clicking on stupid things and you know, it doesn't require much brain power at all. And I thought, I just don't want to make a game like that because those are the easiest types of puzzle games to create, and there's going to be tons of developers doing that kind of thing. So even if there isn't a big supply yet, there will be soon. And sure enough, that's what exploded. And my gosh, with like the App Store for Google or Apple or whatever, you see just tons of those types of games out there where they don't require much brain power at all to play, and you can play them in a break. That And that's totally fine. I mean, there's a place for that type of thing. But it was an area I just felt like I didn't want to get into. I didn't feel like I would respect myself as a game developer. And I didn't think it would be very easy to compete in that long term. So I went to the higher end of the mental scale, and I thought, I'm gonna make games that are really challenging mentally. Like, you've gotta be pretty smart to figure these things out. Puzzle games that are really rack your brain to solve them. And so I focused on that end of the market, because I thought those games are harder to design and there'll be less competition. And yes, maybe fewer people will download them, but I could carve out a little niche there, which would probably be good. And sure enough, that's what worked. And the game I wrote went on to win several awards, and it sold great, like way, way better, you know, orders of magnitude better than what I did before. So that was a good lesson to look for the people, you know, find out who that target market is. And I was looking for people who, you know, a good example would be people who love chess. So they like challenging themselves mentally, and they want other types of challenges. They're going to really push their mind to think. And I liked dealing with those kinds of players too, because they were smart players. So it was nice people to deal with. And they often sent me articles or resources or things like that that could help me. So number one, the people. Figure out who the people are. And you know, one other thing I'll add to this is that you can get confused thinking that your family and friends are the right people to bounce your ideas off of. And that's only true if they're the right people you want to offer your value to. Otherwise, their feedback is probably useless. So don't bother, you know, inviting their feedback so much. Okay, step number two. Step number two is, now you got to figure out what the problem or challenge or transformation you want to offer to these people is. Like, what do they need? What are their needs? What kind of demand do they have that's not being fulfilled? Where can you give them some value? Where can you play a role? What is the nature of that value? And you don't want to guess here. You want to ask. You can ask them. You can survey them. You can do market research, like I did with my computer game. As a more recent example, when I was designing Conscious Growth Club, I had an initial idea for it, which was just pretty rough. But before I even came up with the idea for it, what I did was I sent an email to my newsletter list, and I asked people, I said, if you're willing, tell me what your biggest problem or challenge is right now in life, especially with respect to personal growth or lifestyle design. What's troubling you? You know, tell me. And I got back hundreds of replies, and it was a lot. I must have spent like 20 hours just reading all the replies, taking notes, and then replying to people and thanking them for their answers. And then I typed up all of it and tried to make sense of it. And the problem was, because there were hundreds of replies, there were hundreds of different answers, and they were all over the place. It was not like there was like one core center where everybody had the same type of transformation they were working on. And I thought, wow, okay, well, that doesn't surprise me, because I write on so many different topics that, you know, I have a pretty broad audience. So I thought, how do I help these people then? Because I know the people really well. I've met them, and I've met hundreds of them in person. I've spent hundreds of hours interacting with the people in my audience face to face. But how am I going to create something? And my goal was to create something new that would help them with the transformations they wanted. And I was eventually able to compress it and summarize what they shared down to about 11 different transformations. And I thought, that's still a lot. How do I do this in like one product? I was thinking I'm going to make, you know, like a course or something, or, you know, some kind of 30-day coaching program, or maybe a 6-week thing as an initial, you know, stab at doing some more products online, which I haven't done much at all. And, you know, this was like daunting. I'm like, wow, this is a huge deal. So, but I got the answers I wanted. I thought, wow, okay, so I got the answers. This is a lot of possibilities here. If you have something like a Facebook group, or you're on other forms of social media, or you have a blog, you can do this with your audience too. Or if you have an email list, that's great. If not, you could just start going around trying to meet the people who are going to be potentially in your target audience. And if not that, what some people do is they invest in Facebook advertising. Because with Facebook advertising, you can really target specific groups, like people who like guitar or who have taken guitar lessons or whatever, and then just target those people, and you place an ad to them, and you put up you know, some kind of like offer or freebie, like a free lesson or something like that, and you get them to sign up for your mailing list in exchange for that. And then you have now you have a little bit of list, and it won't be that expensive to you know, build a list of 100, 200, 300 people, and now you have some people you can bounce ideas off of and even sell to later if you want. So that's, you know, it's not really that difficult to build a list. If you want to Google more about that, there's all kinds of you know, people who have advice on list building. So, you know, but basically you need to find the people first and then figure out what their problems and challenges are. And some of their problems and challenges will be ones that you just can't solve. But if you find something that you can solve or you can address, great. Now we go into step three, okay? Step three is you need to figure out what it would take to actually solve that problem for them or help them overcome that challenge or provide that value that they're looking for. So at this step, you're roughly designing the solution. Now, this may, depending on the nature of the solution that you come up with, require you to develop some new skills and educate yourself a bit, because you may not be capable of providing the solution initially. That's almost always the case, like in game development. Whenever I wanted to come up with something new, some creative new game, I had to learn new technical skills. I had to figure out how to do certain things. That's what game programming is all about. You're always trying to discover how to do new things on a machine. For Conscious Growth Club that I'm working on now, why do you think I'm doing this video series? It's partly, in large part actually, because I want to get skill at doing video, because part of my solution that I came up with was to do video courses. And so I felt like, wow, that would be something that would help provide the solution. I could provide really in-depth training and coaching. And I'm also planning to do live coaching calls. So I've done some one-on-one coaching, like over Skype or FaceTime. But you know, getting into doing a lot more video, that's something I'm thinking, okay, I need to upgrade my skills. So I'm educating myself. I also set up a video studio in my house. I haven't used it for this series yet because I want to explore just in other simpler ways to get comfortable with doing video and gain skill at it. But you know, the basic idea is figuring out what it would take to solve the problem. Now, you know, that is something that can take some time. But at this point, it's step three that we're in. All you're doing is taking a rough stab at it. Like, what does the solution generally look like? Now, when I looked at those 11 transformations that I had, that people wanted, I thought, well, I could do 11 different products, 11 different workshops. Damn, that's a lot of work. But then I realized also, a lot of people are gonna have multiple transformations that they wanna work on. It wasn't like each person only had one of these. I mean, many people have 5 of them, 8 of them they wanted to work on. So I thought, if we could create something that would nail all of these in one place, that would be something. Like, that would be something that could appeal to all these people. But it seemed like, wow, this is going to be a big project. but I roughly designed the solution. I thought, okay, this is not something I can do in like a 30-day thing or as like a weekend workshop. That's not going to help the people go all the way there to their transformation. That may get them started on their journey. And that's typically what workshops do, is they help people make get new insights and get some motivation and make some changes and they get started, but then they still have to do a lot on their own. But I was thinking of this in terms of like, how do we take people all the way? And I encourage you to do that too. If you can create something that takes people, that gives them really the value they're seeking, like takes them all the way there, it's so much better than just getting them started on their journey. So for instance, let's say you're a dating coach, and you know, it's one thing to just take somebody out and teach them some dating skills. It's another thing to help them actually find a relationship partner or get them through their first date experience, like get them all the way past that so that they're actually receiving the full value that they wanted, not just the education or the basic skills to get them started, but take them all the way through their journey if you can. So, you know, at this point, you've got a rough idea. You've got a stab for what you're looking for. And I should finish the earlier thought, but, you know, about, so I have these 11 transformations, and I'm thinking, okay, that's, you know, I need something big for this. So my rough idea was, okay, this is going to require a long time. We got to work together a lot. I'm going to do it online so more people can access it. I'm going to do is a one-year coaching program, and I just had three components to it. We'll have live video coaching calls, and we'll have a private discussion forum where everybody can connect, and we'll have online video courses. And the courses will also be transformed into audio and text, so people can access in different formats. And that was basically the idea. And so, you know, that was step three for me. Just come up with a rough idea of how I would do that. So it's like a one-year coaching program with these three components. Now we move on to step four. And step four is that now you take your idea and you share it with people. You share the rough idea, you invite feedback on it, you use the feedback to improve the idea, and you iterate. And you just keep doing that, step four, and with your target market, and get their feedback. So what I did is I emailed my newsletter list this idea, and it was just maybe a couple of paragraphs. And I did that earlier this year. And I said, here's the idea I'm thinking of creating. And what do you guys think? And that was it. And then, you know, a couple hundred replies later, and another 20 hours of reading all the feedback and taking really detailed notes on it, I got a lot of insights. People told me, yeah, sounds interesting, but have you thought about this? Is it going to have this? They asked me questions about it. I thought, okay, so there's some interest, but it's a little bit weak right now. And some people were like, yeah, I would love that. So, you know, you have some of the gung-ho fans and some people who are just sort of skeptical about the idea. They need to see more. And of course, that's what you would expect. So if you're doing this for yourself, you know, this is your book idea, like your story idea. What do you think of a story about this? And if you're creating a music album, it might be like, okay, here's like a small 30-second clip of a song. What do you think? And so you're just taking your initial stab at it and basically sharing that with people and getting their feedback. And then when you get that feedback, you refine the idea and you do it again. So then after a week or so of going, you know, of refining the idea, then I share another version. And this other version is several paragraphs long now. I share that. Now I'm noticing that there's more excitement. The responses are more enthusiastic because I've listened to people and I put in some of the things that people were suggesting. And there's more questions about it too, because the more you fill out the idea, the more there are other branches that, you know, people will find to add to it or improve, or other things people, or the more you share also that people may find something in it they don't like. So then there was another round of feedback. And then eventually, you know, after multiple rounds of feedback, I typed up like this massive document. I think it came out to be about 16,000 words. In the end, and I put it on my website, and I said, okay, if you really want to see the whole big picture design now, go to this page and read it if you have time. And some people just skimmed it, and some people read the whole thing. And then they were giving me feedback like, I want to give you my credit card now. I want to sign up for this now. And so that's when you're golden. That's when you really have something, when people are saying, yes, I love this. And this is all just the design phase. It hasn't been created yet. You're just explaining the idea to people. You're saying, this is what I'm going to create. What do you think of this? And this is, you know, very much the opposite model of doing this all in a vacuum by yourself. If you really want to provide value for people and make sure you don't miss, then involve those people that you're going to be providing the value to in the creative process. I think it's just a real huge time saver. Because one of the greatest risks of trying to provide value for people is creating something that people don't value. So this way you can have a much better chance of hitting your target market. Now, this is not a common thing in many fields. Like, I don't know too many artists who actually involve their customers in the art creation process. You know, like sharing a rough sketch and say, what do you think of this? You know, it's more like, hey, I'm the artist, and I'm great and I'm creative, and here's art for you. And if you like it, great. And if you don't, oh well. It means, you know, you're not seeing the vision that I've created. And sure, that's one way to create art, and maybe you'll achieve greatness, but obviously most don't. Maybe a lot more artists would achieve greatness if they actually figured out who their audience was and designed art for those people. Also in alignment with their own skills and their own desires, their own self-expression. Doesn't negate any of that, but involve the people a bit in the creative process and get their feedback along the way. And I think, you know, I think people would really like that. Okay, so that's step four, is share the idea with your target market, get their feedback, and iterate. Obviously, it's better to be able to show people something than tell them. Since I'm designing a coaching program, it's hard to show them that. But if you're doing art, music, you know, anything that you can put in a, you know, have a sample or a demo, you can put it in some kind of form, that's great. When I was creating a computer game, the one that sold really well, I would have people come over to my house and play it. And they'd sit at my computer and I'd stand behind them with a legal pad and I'd take notes while they were playing. And I'd note where they got stuck, what they seemed to like. I'd note also if they wanted to play another level, that was a good sign. And I'd make improvements based on their feedback, make tweaks and things. Or maybe they found a way to short circuit a level and solve it in a way I hadn't expected. And then I might want to change the design a little bit. So, you know, this kind of thing of evolving the idea with your target market, really, really useful, really helpful. It greatly reduces the risk of having a flop. And I'm sure if you think about it, you can come up with, you know, all kinds of examples of different ways to do this. I think Tim Ferriss mentioned that to come up with his book cover for one of his books, he had a mock-up created and then stuffed it in some bookstores and you know, watched to see who picked it up off the shelf. if the book, you know, if the cover got some attention there. So obviously if you're sticking it in the right section of the bookstore where your book will be sold, then you're at least getting close to your target market. So again, not a bad idea. What's step five? Well, step five is now when you've done this iterative process with people and you know you've got something, now you can release it. Now you can start working on you could put it up for sale or give it away or whatever you want to do with it. Obviously, if you're doing something simpler, like just creating an article, you don't need to go through all these steps because you'll get feedback on the article. And the way I see it with blogging is that my blog itself is kind of this evolutionary process where each article is a test, you know, checking to see, is this going to provide value for what people want? And it's not the only thing that's important in blogging. There are other things that are important aside from just providing value, but that's certainly a huge part of it. And if, you know, if I would get feedback and it would be very flat, I think, okay, that article missed. And so after writing well over 1,000 articles, I have a pretty good pulse on what people want to see and what actually provides value for them and what's hitting home for them, what gets under their skin, what they really want to hear, what they need help with. And I can write with that in mind. So I'm not just wasting my time creating dribble that nobody reads. And I think I've done pretty well there because since I started, I'd say more than 100 million people have been to my website. So that's certainly worked well. And now it's very, now that, you know, things are very distributed because I uncopyrighted my work in 2010. So all my blog posts are uncopyrighted. These videos, by the way, they're all uncopyrighted. So feel free to share them, translate them, republish them, do whatever you want with them. You own these videos as much as I do. And that just like, you know, spreads things much further. So now not all the traffic is coming to me. It's all over the place. If you're thinking of creating some kind of value for people, really think about this five-step process. It's not that complicated, but it's not a commonly used process. So again, you know, step one is figure out who the people are. Step two is identify their problems or challenges or the transformation that you want to provide for them or the value you want to provide for them. What is that? And you're doing that by asking them, surveying them, doing market research, that sort of thing. Step three is figure out, in a rough form, what will it take to solve that? What will it take to deliver that value? So just making like a rough design, coming up with a rough idea. Step four is share that rough idea, get some feedback on it, go and improve your idea based on the feedback, and then just keep iterating through that. Keep sharing the new idea, the refined idea. It'll probably get longer and more complex as you go along, and you may get fewer people wanting to give you feedback as it gets lengthier or more complicated, but those will be probably the core people in your target market if they're willing to stay with you that whole time. And keep evolving the idea until people are saying, yeah, that looks good. How do I sign up? How do I buy this? I want this now. When you start seeing that demand, that's great. And if you find your idea is not getting to that point, maybe start fresh with a new idea or even a new target audience. And step five is now when you got something really good, release it. You know, put it out there. And then, you know, that's, you're going to have a much better chance of having something really golden that people love if you involve your target market in the creative process. So, you know, you violate this idea at your peril. Okay, I really understand the idea that we should be awesome creative people and just create art, you know, from our own genius and then share it with the world, and everybody will, of course, value it. And the truth is that just doesn't happen. You're likely to be a very private secret genius that goes unappreciated. That may wear on you after a while, and if you eventually get bored with being the secret genius, maybe you want to become a more social genius and get a little bit more aligned with what people want and involve them in the process and do this in a more co-creative way instead of getting your ego all wrapped up into it and thinking that you got to do this all by yourself, because you really don't. It really is a lot more fun, I think, to involve people in the creative process. It raises your motivation and excitement, because now you have people, even before you've created anything, just the idea you're putting out there, now you get people who are excited and they want to work with you on this, and you know, people will offer you help and suggestions. I've got so many offers for help and suggestions on ideas I've shared. It's beautiful, and it makes it more motivating to continue. This is one of the reasons I don't have writer's block, because I always feel like there are people wanting me to give them something, wanting me to create something. And this, you know, this video series too is interactive. So if you have ideas for which videos I should create next, you know, let me know. I'm all ears. What can I do to help you? What do you want help with? What are your problems and challenges that I can help you with? So, you know, you inform me and I help create stuff. So it's, you know, and we're really co-creating this series together, because I am listening to feedback as we go along and thinking about, okay, what do we create next? So I don't have this whole series all mapped out. I don't know what I'll be doing, you know, throughout for the rest of the whole series. So that's all to be determined. Anyway, I hope you enjoy this, you know, this five-step process for how to provide value for other people, how to raise your level of contribution without having to take so much risk of creating something in the dark. I'll see you tomorrow.